start with topic fibroid. There are two types of tumors inside the body. One is cancerous, that means malignant tumor, and another is a non-cancerous, also called as a benign tumor. Fibroids are a type of benign tumor of a muscular and fibrous tissue of the uterus. So now, this diagram will show you the various types of the fibroid. See? Some fibroids which lies within the uterus. Some lies inside the muscular layer of the uterus. While some lies outside the uterus. These uterine fibroids are attached directly in the layers without any projection, called as a non-pedunculated. While this fibroid, it is joined to the uterus with a peduncle, so it is called as pedunculated fibroid. Now go for various types of fibroids in detail. So first type, whether they are attached with a peduncle like projection or directly intermingled with the corresponding layer. So there are two types, pedunculated and non-pedunculated. Pedunculated type, when fibroid got attached to uterus with small peduncle. And non-pedunculated type, when fibroids are attached to the uterus without any peduncle. Another types of the fibroid depends on the sites where the fibroids are. So it may be inside the uterus, called as a intrauterine fibroids. The fibroids which lies outside the uterus are called extrauterine fibroids. And some fibroids which lies in the cervix are called as a cervical fibroids. Now the main types of the fibroid, where the types are according to which layer they involve. So first type is intramural type, which is the commonest type of the fibroid. When the fibroid lies within the muscular wall of the uterus, and hence as they grows in size, causes overstretching of the uterus. So intramural type, when fibroid lies within the muscular wall of the uterus. Next type, that is a submucosal fibroid. The name itself suggests that these fibroids develops in the middle layer of the uterus, that means myometrium, muscles of the uterus. The third type of the fibroid is a subserosal fibroid. These fibroids involve the serous layer of the uterus, and most of these lies outside the uterus. These fibroids are responsible for more pressure symptoms in the fibroid patients. Now go for etiological factors for the fibroid. Fibroids are more sensitive to estrogen and progesterone. These are highly sensitive for these hormones. So more will be the exposure for estrogen and progesterone, there is a growth of the fibroid. The probable causes for the fibroids are large spacing between two children. So the gap between two children, if it is more, there are the more chances of fibroid. Next cause, the rate is high in women those taken prolonged oral contraceptive pills. You all know oral contraceptive pills are maybe single hormonal or mixed hormonal, that is containing derivatives of estrogen and progesterone. More will be exposure to the oral contraceptive pills, more will be the exposure to estrogen and progesterone, and hence there are more chances of fibroid. Next cause, the rate of fibroid is higher in reproductive age group. That means, since puberty up to the climacteric age, as estrogen and progesterone secretions are more in this age group. Another cause, during pregnancy. Same cause, that is, there is an increased level of estrogen and progesterone during pregnancy. So, if patient having already a small fibroid, there are more chances to growing fibroid during pregnancy. Next cause of fibroid, genetic mutations. Some genetic mutations can show the tendency of fibroids in the patient. Next cause, that is a family history. If patient's mother or sister having a history of fibroid, the patient has more prone to form the fibroids. Next cause, that is the excessive intake of meat, alcohol, caffeine. It is a universal observation. Next, overweight or obesity. Next cause, that is vitamin D deficiency. The etiological factors increases the risk of fibroid, while there are some factors which decreases the risk. So, one of that factor is with each delivery, there is a risk decreased. Next cause, that is a menopause. Around the climacteric age and at the menopause, there is a decrease in level of estrogen and progesterone. As the growth of the fibroid is depend on these two hormones, there is a loss of growth during the menopause and fibroid automatically shrinks. Another decreased risk factor is increased intake of fruits and vegetables. Now go for clinical features of the fibroid. More will be the size, more will be the symptoms. Small will be the fibroid, less will be the symptom. Again, the clinical features will depend on the location and numbers of the fibroid. If patient having symptoms, the most common symptoms are constant pelvic pains, constant dull aching lower abdominal pains with heaviness of the abdomen is the constant symptom in the fibroid uterus. These pains can't be vanished with any measurement. Another symptom is spasmodic or membranous dysmenorrhea. Severe spasmodic pains with passing of thick clotted membranous blood with the cervical bearing down sensation is the another characteristic symptom of the fibroid uterus. As the estrogen and progesterone again causes endometrial hyperplasia, the patient also shows clinical features related to menstrual irregularities. So those symptoms are menorrhagia, that means prolonged heavy menstruation, metrorrhagia, that is PV bleeding or spotting in between two menses, DOB, that means dysfunctional uterine bleeding. All these menstrual irregularities directly leads to another clinical feature, that is anemia due to excessive blood loss. If these fibroids are extrauterine, then the site of the fibroid will decide one-sided abdominal pains, especially when they are huge in size. Another common symptom in the fibroid is constant backache and leg pains. Now, the huge fibroid produces extra pressure symptoms. The pressure over which organ they produce, those symptoms are present in those patients. If the pressure over the bladder, the patient having symptom of difficult emptying of bladder followed by recurrent urinary tract infection. If the pressure over the rectum, the patient having complaining of constipation. If there is a pressure over the diaphragm, the distended abdomen causes difficult respiration. If the pressure over the ovaries, there is premenstrual pain due to ovarian congestion. Now, let's decide the complications. Due to huge blood loss, patient having complaint of moderate to severe anemia. Again, the fundal fibroids or the cervical fibroids causes obstruction to fertilization, and hence most of the patient shows infertility. Next complication, recurrent abortions. As the fibroids are space occupying lesions, they may cause preterm labor. As the normal site of the uterus for the placental implantation get replaced by the fibroid, the placenta has to search the another site to implant. So most of the patient shows placenta previa, especially in fundal fibroid conditions. Then the complication like abruptio placenta. Next complication, that is IUGR, that is intrauterine growth retardation. Why? Because fibroid will causes deviation of uterine blood supply towards own cell. So there is a comparatively decreased blood supply to the growing baby, which ultimately leads to IUGR. Another cause that the fibroid is a space occupying lesion, so it obstructs the growth of the growing baby. Again, this can cause placental insufficiency and hence IUD, that means intrauterine death. Fibroid may cause labor abnormalities like prolonged and obstructed labor. Now, we will go towards the pathogenesis of the fibroid. That means if fibroid remains at a place for long time in the negligence, what will be happen with the fibroid? There are different possibilities with the fibroid. If fibroid is around the menopause, directly goes to the atrophy. So the first degeneration is atrophy of the fibroid. Another type, when it is around the reproductive stage, especially during the pregnancy, then it will be goes to the inflammation, congestion, and that is called as a red degeneration. In this condition, fibroids are more active and in growth stage. Next will be the infection to the fibroid. Next pathogenesis is related to necrosis of the fibroid. And last, that is a calcification of the fibroid, where the calcification of the growth taken place and it becomes stone-like hard structure. Now, diagnosis. How will you diagnose that patient having a fibroid? So, the characteristic clinical symptoms are itself diagnosis of the fibroid. So, clinical symptoms of menstrual irregularities and per-abdominal examination of palpable lump or uterine irregularities will indicate towards the fibroid. But the confirmation is necessary to rule out the type, numbers and the exact location of the fibroid, and that type of diagnosis can be done by USG, that is ultrasonography. There are some other methods where fibroid can be diagnosed. So that first is hysterosonography. It is a saline infusion sonogram to expand the uterine cavity and used to visualize the submucosal type of fibroid. Another investigation, that is a hysterosalpingography. Next, hysteroscopy. It is a telescopic intrauterine view. And last, MRI. Now, management. The first rule is no symptoms, no management. Mild symptoms, no management is required if symptoms are tolerable. In elder patients with tolerable symptoms, just wait and watch, as the atrophy will occur at around menopause. So start with medicinal management of the fibroid. That is an oral management. So first symptoms, first treatment is symptomatic treatment. That means if there is a pain, you give the painkillers. If there is a hemorrhage, give the antihemorrhagics. So non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are easily used as a pain reliever. Antihemorrhagic remedies to control the blood loss. The commonest drugs used for uterine bleeding is tranexamic acid and ethambutol. Ethambutol causes vasoconstriction, so there is a restriction in use of ethambutol in hypertensive patient. Next, medicinal management is growth hormone releasing hormone agonist. So these will reduce the size by blocking the estrogen and progesterone. Some intrauterine devices can be used as a medicinal management of the fibroid. For example, progesting. Now, minimal surgical procedures. First, uterine artery embolism. So here, some embolic agents get injected inside the uterine artery to cut down the blood supply to the fibroid. But the risk for this uterine artery embolism, that this method can decrease the blood supply of that uterine wall also, may goes to the necrotic changes or atrophic changes. Next surgical procedure, that is a radiofrequent ablation, also called as a cryomyolysis. It is a laparoscopic transcervical procedure used to shrink down the fibroids. Endometrial ablation. It is a microwavic destruction of the endometrium to control the blood loss. And last, hysteroscopic myomectomy. That means scopically removal of the fibroid. These all minimal surgical procedures are used where the uterus is required to conserve and the fibroid has to be removed or undergone into the controlled group. But if patient having a severe symptoms, severe complications of the fibroid, and there is a no need of the conservation of the uterus, need to advise for major surgeries, that is abdominal myomectomy, where we have to preserve the uterus to fertility. Then hysterectomy. Hysterectomy, it is a main procedure, that is removal of the uterus will be the last aid in case of the fibroid. Minimal procedures like uterine artery embolism, endometrial ablation, cryomyolysis may cause infertility in the patients. Now, go for the homeopathic management. Homeopathic remedies can easily control the growth of the fibroid. Also, some remedies has the power to expel out the fibroid. So, go for the remedies. First remedy is aurum neuraticum. It is indicable for those workaholic ladies which having a hypertension, a depressed mind and palpitation on overthinking. This remedy is very useful in shrinking the fibroid. That means this remedy will preserve the uterus. Next remedy, that is a calcarea carb. As you know, the constitution of the calcarea carb is fatty, flabby, sluggish, obese, white. So, this is the remedy for stout, dull, obese, extremely chilly lady which having a history of lest menarche. The patient shows heavy menses aggravated by slightest motions. Another remedy that is an all-rounder in the woman, that is sepia. Sepia is a climacteric or menopausal age group remedy. So easily indicable for depressed menopausal ladies which having history of recurrent abortions and recurrent deliveries. This remedy is indicable for all type of menstrual irregularities. Patient having complaint of heavy abdomen, constant backache, recurrent urinary tract infections and symptoms of uterine prolapse. Another remedy, that is phosphorus. Phosphorus is the remedy for the young reproductive age group ladies which have anemia. So weak, thin, anemic, depressed, stoop-shouldered, fair, sensitive, chilly ladies with DUB or necrotic fibroids. This remedy having tendency of pale discoagulable bleeding from any orifice of the body as well as having a tendency of progression of the disease as it having all three miasms in the background. The lady have tubercular diathesis. Another remedy which is excellent for the fibroid, that is a calcarea flour. Calcarea flour remedy shows multiple calcified stony hard fibroids. Patient are having also symptoms related to joints, hemorrhoids and varicose veins. These patients though belong from the calcarea group, like calcarea fos, having an emaciation of the whole body, and it is due to calcium deficiency and osteopenia. Next remedy for the fibroid is a thuja. As you know, thuja is a king of antipsychotic remedy, so applicable for all type of overgrowth in the hydrogenoid constitutions. These patients easily get affected by the damp weather or water. The other constitution of the thuja patient is the moon phase hirsutism. The mentals of the thuja patients are again characteristic where there are different hallucinations and illusions as if live animal present in the uterus. Thuja remedy shows new moon, full moon aggravation of the complaints. Another excellent remedy which act over the glands is the conium. Conium having all glandular affections due to suppressed sexual desires or prolonged suppressed injuries. Another excellent remedy which having an expulsive power, that is apis. Apis having a severe characteristic stinging pains in the hot patient. Again, the cause of the fibroid in the apis is suppressed sexual desire, suppressed anger, suppressed indignation and jealousy. There are many other remedies which can manage the patient as the symptomatic management. For example, for the abdominal pains, some remedies are Magfos, Plumbummet, Bryonia, Peladona, Chamomilla. These remedies having their typical type of pains as well as the constitution. For example, Magfos is the remedy for the congestive dysmenorrhea where patient having better by pressure and hot application. Plumbummet is the remedy where there is a pulling drawn sensation around the umbilicus. Bryonia is the remedy where patient having a constant stitching abdominal pains with excessive dryness. Peladona is the remedy of the congestion where there is a constant thrombing pain and hence applicable for the red degeneration of the fibroid. Chamomilla is the remedy for the pain where patient having intolerable pains and screams with the pain. The another important clinical feature is anger and convulsion during the pains. Nothing pleases the patient. Another symptomatic management is with anti-hemorrhagic remedies. So, characteristic hemorrhagic remedies are Magcar, where the bleeding is like a washing of meat. Cinchona, again it is a anti-hemorrhagic remedy where profuse arterial blood loss with profound weakness. Ferumet is the remedy where there is a false plethora, anemia and severe arterial blood loss. Lachesis is the remedy which is in the hot patient at the climacteric age with bluish constitution, with trembling and protruded tongue and profuse bluish membranous discharges. Hamemalis is the remedy for the constant oozing of capillary bleeding. There are some another expulsive remedies which having power to expel out the small fibroids. For example, Cilicia, which again called as a surgeon's knife, Apis, Cantharides and Sickle Cord. Thank you everybody. And this is a topic by Dr. Varsha Patil.